So welcome, guys. Welcome to our Abundance Masterclass. And I'm jazzed because you're going to learn some really cool shifting pieces from this little mini class. And they'll be built in time for you to go ahead and do the work while you're taking the class. So for those of you who are just watching via video, you'll be able to stop the video and just work on it and then start it again. So the first thing that I want to tackle before I even start giving you details about all of this is I want you to write down and define how you feel about your abundance presently as you look at your life right now. So you just spend some time, for those of you who can use your computer, use your journal or what have you, I want you to define how you feel about your abundance currently and where it's at. Okay, so that's your first step. All right. So now I want you to reread it. Okay, reread it first, and then I want you to identify where you'd like to see the abundance go. You know, where you are heading, what trajectory you're heading on, where you foresee it, where you're gonna feel good about your abundance, what has to happen for you to feel good about your abundance. All right, so your next step is to define now how you spiritually look at abundance. And I want you to define what spirituality feels like when it's an abundant state, which is a little different than what we've been writing about already. So spend a few minutes on trying to connect that piece for yourself. And we're gonna get into that. That leads me into my next place. So when we look at spirituality from an abundance standpoint, we are looking at this ideal vision of what we have for abundance. So we tend to look at it as this this thing that flows. We know it flows, but yet we don't experience the flow. And we don't align ourselves with that space. We don't align ourselves thinking that's somehow unavailable to us, right? So it flows almost as an expectation. And this gets me into my next section, which is perfect because I want you to look at nature, right? And I want you to look at a flower or a tree or a river or a waterfall or any of those things. Okay? And there is abundance everywhere in that, right? That there is just this knowing, there is this expectation that it just knows what to do. It's a divine intelligence. There's nothing that tells the flower to bud. There's nothing that tells the acorn to get into a tree. And there's nothing that tells the river to flow. There is an expectation that it is just supposed to happen that way. It is supposed to just develop, uncover, discover, you know, unearth that way. That is abundance, right? When a flower buds, it's abundant, right? It's full of life versus when it's underground and it's struggling to survive or something, but it doesn't go through that really. It expects to happen. But we don't treat ourselves with that same expectation. We like to put a lot of dirt on top of our shit, on top of our seeds, right? Because we love the effort. We are built to effort our way to abundance because we're built to survive. Our brains are built to survive. They don't align naturally with abundance. Now, our source, our soul, our source, our God, divinity type energy that we all have is aligned to be abundant. But this reality keeps us in a space of non-abundance. It keeps us in a space of feeling like you're gonna have to effort your way to abundance. And that's unnatural when you think of it in those terms, right? That's nothing, you don't see anything in nature struggling that way. When you see a flower growing through fucking cement, you're not questioning whether or not it was able to do it. It just did it. It's one of the most delicate things on the planet, and yet it grew through concrete, a crack in the concrete. So if a flower can do that in its most delicate of moments and its most delicate makeup cellularly, then why can't we thrive in an environment like that, right? So I want you to think about the things that happen in nature, okay? And I want you to think about the flower and the tree and the river and the weather, you know, all these factors that just happen. They have this internal knowing. They have this unmentionable intelligence that no one, not even science, can really explain. They are simply built to bloom, built to grow, built to thrive, and reach their fullest potential. It is an expectation that they will reach their fullest potential, but yet we don't treat ourselves with that same thing. It's interesting, right? So I want you to write out examples of divine intelligence that you see happening in the world. I mentioned a few of them, obviously, flower, trees, whatever. But I want you to think about just things that are just happening in the world. I mean, we don't tell our fingernails to grow. I think that's one of Wayne Dyer's favorite things, right? We don't tell our heart to beat, yes.
Or breathe.
Yes, exactly. So, you know, I want you to write out just a bullet point list of just things that you see happening naturally in the world around you that are just happening. They're just energy happening. So that's your next thing. Bullet points. Shouldn't take you too long. All right, so the idea is that we just looked at kind of how things are happening in nature, right? And how there is this knowing that nature has. And we look at it, we respect it. We respect it so greatly, but yet we don't respect it within ourselves. So I think it's safe to say that we can understand that we are not that different from nature. We are not different from the flower. We're not that different from the tree. We're all connected. We're all made up of the same kind of matter, black matter, energy, and what have you. So if we know this about nature, can we not safely say that we know this about ourselves? Doesn't it not make sense that we could know this about ourselves, right? Yeah. So I want you to talk about kind of your personal divine intelligence, and it's going to take a second to kind of connect with, but what do you feel you believe to be true about the world and the universe as far as your physical presence here? So meaning, you know, when you look at the things that are happening, you probably have some of these things in your list already, but I just want you to think for a moment. You know, what are some of the divine intelligences that are happening in your current world? And that comes back to the beating of your heart. That comes down to, you know, your body just knows how to breathe. That comes down, your body knows how to calculate the food that comes into your body, right? And sustain life. That your body just knows how to do this. That your brain knows how to handle emotions and how it feeds your body, and vice versa, like where you feel your second brain in your stomach and how it tells your brain what to do. I want you to think for a second about that relationship, okay? So the relationship of your divine intelligence, and just marinate it on it for a second before we move to the next space. Just kind of follow up that with some thoughts about how you relate to nature and how nature relates to you and how you're both equally worthy of the expectation of abundance. The next obvious question to me then is, then why the fuck do we struggle so hard? Like, why are we...
Love, that's why I'm here.
Right? Why are we struggling so hard? You know, why does that happen? Why don't we hit our fullest potential? And it's because that we are the one organism on our planet or in the universe that has the ability to say no. A flower can't say no, right? You know, a waterfall can't say no. A tree can't say no. our beating heart even can't say no to a degree, right?
Right.
So only this can say no. This prefrontal cortex in our brain and our ability to think about our thinking, it is unique to the universe, as unique as DNA or a fingerprint, okay? So what happens is when we observe that there is scarcity, and when we are really observing, what we're really observing is not necessarily scarcity, but it is our disconnect with self and our disconnect with source. So what seems like I don't have any money, I don't have any abundance, is really I'm not completely aligned with source. Yeah? So a lack, and that's just a lack of appreciation, a cutting off from or a knowing of your divine intelligence, the thing that's already given to you, your born intelligence. So what happens is that we tend to kind of align more with what's happening on the outside world because we have to live in the outside world. I mean, it's kind of natural for us to want to do that, and less with the inside world, which is more natural, which is more connected to everything in the surroundings, our nature, everything around us. And, you know, it's a tough habit to break. I know, because I have to try to break it all the time. As spiritual beings, it's really hard because our instinct, especially those who are awake, enlightened, and what have you, and those of us who adopt the idea that we believe that, like, the law of attraction happens, right? That it's real, that it's real for that, for us. It's somehow just enough, like, out of our reach. Like, and I don't, like, sometimes I think, how is that possible? Like, I believe in the law of attraction. So why is it feel like it's just not in my reach, right? And it doesn't seem to make sense to me. And so what we do is we try to fix it. We slap this beautiful Band-Aid, right, on it, going, I'm going to think more positively. And I'm going to will my fucking way to my abundance. And I'm going to effort my way, which I mentioned, to my abundance. And we try to fix it by going, you know, I am abundant. Energy flows to me. Abundance flows to me. And we use all these really compelling words to get us to this space, right? And the problem is that as soon as we affirm that we need to, like, have abundance in our life, we also affirm the fact that it doesn't exist in our life.
Okay.
Right? So it's a relationship. So I think Abraham Hicks puts it this way. So when you pick up a stick, on both sides, on one side you have abundance, the other side you have no abundance. You're picking up the same fucking stick, right?
Yes.
And it's both there. So whether you teeter, how you teeter from a vibration and energy standpoint, and mind the high-flying discs and what have you, wherever you stand on that space, it means you are either going to fall into abundance or going to fall, you know, away from it, because you're still picking up the idea of abundance. And if you're asking, I really need some money to come into my bank account, you're also saying, I really don't have any money in my fucking bank account.
It's something that you need.
Yeah.
That you don't already have it.
Yes.
You aren't even in alignment with it.
Yes. So the idea is that we need to be able to get ourselves into a higher vibration. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, let me see here. Let me get back to my notes. So, as we are trying each day, especially those of us who are practicing our inner work regularly, to learn about, you know, who we are and our relationship to the universe, we can actually start cutting ourselves off from the divine intelligence. We dissect ourselves. We become highly aware of our missteps. It's almost backfiring on us to a degree. And if we spend all of our time seeking, we'll do no finding. Now, this is in the area of abundance, because I happen to be a big believer in seekers and that we should always be seeking, but you kind of get my drift, right? So in all my groups, I ask them, I ask my clients, I ask all of you guys all the time to be super clear about what you want, right? And I think that is still super important. But I'm going to offer you an alternative here, especially when you're sitting in a low vibration, because that's me assuming that you're sitting in a high vibration, is for you to get super clear. But I think it's important that we also not ask for the things that we want in that low vibration, because we are affirming the absence of it. So rather than grow the idea of lack, we want to obviously grow the idea of abundance, right? And so we need to figure out how to tell how we're vibrating, right? And where we are. So how do we know? How do we know if we're in a low vibration or a high vibration? So the first thing to look at is things that we've already talked about a little bit, but how are you currently feeling about your abundance and your life in general? And the second question to ask you is, what is currently happening, you know, within your abundance in life? So how do you feel about it? And then what is actually happening? Okay. The trouble is that everything around you also believes in the ideas about your life. So your friends and your family and your bills and your bank account and your credit score, they all believe this story about your abundance, and they affirm to you that that story is spot on. So at this point, I want you to take a moment and write out what you believe living from a high vibration feels like. Okay, what does it mean to you and what does it feel like? So I'm gonna give you a couple minutes for that. Now you might be looking at kind of what you wrote there and going, oh my gosh, how am I gonna get myself to that space every day, right? I mean, it's like the idyllic space is to just feel like you're flying high, that everything's connected, that you feel aligned, and that's a tall order for us to fill every day. So why does getting into that vibration feel really hard? Well, first thing is humans like to feel that we're worth it, right? We like to really get good at what we're really not good at. So we feel like we've got to kind of effort our way to our self-worth. And we're addicted to efforting our way to these things. And we even like decide not to seek support because we feel like having support somehow diminishes our worth. I've go through that so many times. It's the exact reason why I created the receiving program, is because, you know, asking for help has been a sign of weakness in my history. So, you know, telling myself a new story about that and understanding that is all obviously really important, right? So what's the next obvious question? The next obvious question is, how do we raise our vibration, right? And we have to start with the things that we have little to no resistance with. So, you know, if you are looking around your house right now, or wherever you're sitting at your office or what have you, and just look around and what do you see? Like, you might see a pen on your desk, or you might see a vase across the hall, or you may be sitting in your kitchen with a cup of coffee. Anything that you have really little to no resistance about, okay? And you're just gonna look around, and that's where you wanna start. You know, it's like I'm looking at a lamp right now in my apartment, and we just got it, and it's kind of like the starting point of kind of building our new look in our styling of our apartment. And I'm like, wow, it's really pretty. Like, I love how it's designed. I love it that it's clean. I love that it's metal. You know, that's a good place to start, with stuff that you have very little resistance to, okay? And once you notice that you start admiring these things around your house or your, you know, immediate space, be your dog or your cat, you know, any pets that you might have, you'll find that if you just keep admiring and you keep talking and you keep asking yourself why this thing is in your environment, that might not be so compelling with a pen, you know, but I mean, your pen is capable of writing down amazing things, right? So it's all in how you look at it. But the idea is that you get yourself in a momentum. This is what I've called before, and some of you know this, the little push. You know, it's just the little thing, little place to kind of jump off from. It pushes you into a better vibrational state. And that's what I'm looking for you to do. So I want you to make a go-to, just a bullet list, really, a go-to list of ideas for simplistic and non-resistant things, okay? Just make a bullet list of that. We have our list now of go-to things. Now we need to take a little responsibility, right? Some self-responsibility. So I want you to write down, and it can just be a bullet list of ideas or things that come into your space, but I want you to list bullet point the ways of which you have contributed to your lack of financial abundance. What habits, what behaviors, what practices, what systems, okay? So I want you to write those down because we need to take a little sense of responsibility for what those are. It could be that, you know, you've decided that, you know, you go to the store. This is my coach uses this. This is such a great, and we all talk about it. It's a big joke in our little community of who coach with her. You go to the store and you look at, you know, the blueberries and then you look at the strawberries and you choose the strawberries because they're like cheaper than the blueberries. And it's practicing abundance, right? Like, oh, it's like, they're like $5 more. Like, I don't want to get the blueberries, so I'll just settle for the strawberries. Always choose the goddamn blueberries. Every fucking time, okay? So it's those little practices. So look at how you're doing that in your life and these little systems, right? Now, I'm not saying you're not gonna be able to upgrade to first class every time that you hop a plane. It might be financially really irresponsible of you to do that. But the idea is to recognize, hey, that's available to me. At some point, I'm gonna be able to do that. And I'm open to the possibility. I'm willing for that possibility to come into my life, right? So if you can open yourself up to those ideas, start small though, little resistance. Buy the fucking blueberries, okay? So that's the first thing. So write down a list of of how you're contributing to your lack. And kind of attributing this and bringing this, like, even my personal stuff into it, which will help a little bit for you guys to see your own story in it, because I like teaching both my own stories because it just helps you guys see your own story. So I used to believe that if I could understand when or why I came to have abundance issues, that I would be able to put an end to them. I look at my past, I look at my dad, you and I have had that conversation. You know, I've looked at like my relationship with money in the past. And then I've come to understand probably over the last, I don't know, couple of years, I'm like learning, like the more that I put intention into try to figure that out, the vibration stays there, right? My vibrational space stays in that low state. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think I wanna figure it out because I think, oh, if I just figure it out, then I can stop the behavior, I can stop the attitude, I can stop the systems, I can put an end to the torture, you know, of torturing myself over why I don't have abundance in my life or what have you. But it was really a question that even my coach put to me that said, like, if you really knew what it was anyway, would it really make a difference? And I was like, oh, fuck, probably not. If I really knew exactly what it was, the moment or what have you, like, I have some suspicions as to, like, you know, like how my friends would perceive my parents have money and, you know, my parents, you know, had an affluent life and like people judged them for that. And okay, there's all these like little pieces of like why maybe I don't ask for my abundance in the right ways, right? But then if I really, even giving that so much like weight in my life, does that really produce abundance on the other side of it? No, it keeps you at that same vibrational state. So can we accept that when we recognize, that's why I want to just really look at like our habits and our behaviors and stuff like that and really recognize how we're contributing to that our own scarcity, you know, and how we practice that, and that tends to go through our history and what have you. I think it's important to recognize those things so that way you can go, okay, this is where it is important to recognize those things of the past, going, okay, does that really serve me to see it? Not really anymore. Now that you know it, it doesn't serve you anymore. Now you can just move on, you know, knowing that you are prone, prepped, have a rite of passage to your abundance. So can we accept that when we recognize lack, scarcity, issues in our life, that source already knows that, that's fine, but doesn't place any effort on that whatsoever, and has already put in place a means to correct it. Conditions of which to correct that behavior or that issue in your life. Can we accept that when we have an issue come up in our life, especially in the area of abundance, that source is already working on the remedy? And when you have that kind of insurance policy, can we not go, the universe has this, I can carry on with life as normal, right? Carry on as life as abundant, because I know that source has my back and it's already working on a solution for me. It's already bringing me business. It's already, you know, bringing me a raise at work. It's already bringing me another means of being able to put together my abundance mindset, attributing it to my bank account kind of means, right? So the more that we don't have that insurance policy idea or mentality, the more that we are not going to see that result in our bank account, right, in our abundance in life. So we really have to adopt that idea, and it has to be a practice, yes, because we practice for a long time not having it. So I want us to write down at this point why you are worthy of abundance. Okay? So spend bullet points, sentences, however you want to structure it. You know, I am worthy because I know that my intentions are good. I am worthy because I know that I want everybody to win. I know that I am worthy because I bring skills and talent to the table that some people are just not ready to do them for themselves. I bring, you know, abundance into my life, and I'm worthy of it because I know that I have good intentions of being able how to spend it. I spend it on my learning. I spend it on my growth. I invest in myself constantly. So that's the mindset I want you to kind of wrap around and get into when you're writing these things out, like why you're worthy of the abundance. Not because I'm a nice person and not because, you know, I work hard. These are all great things, but you're gonna have to dig deeper than that. I want you to dig below that and like, why do you work hard? I work hard because I have purpose, because I know I have a calling. I know that I'm supposed to be doing this work. And when I hit resistance, it's just not gonna matter because I know that's a part of the game. I know that's a part of why I'm here. And I know that's a part of why I'm gonna be hugely and massively successful. Okay, so you have to take it, kind of layer it down, reverse engineer it, however you wanna like put it into words, but work on that for a few minutes. So when I ask people, you know, what do you want in your life? They have a hard time telling me what that is. Like, what do you want? Like, what do you want out of your life? Who do you want to be? You know, when I ask clients, you know, who are doing like one-on-one sessions with me, you know, what do you want to see come to fruition in your life? They have a hard time placing that into words. But when I ask them, what do you know? What do you know you don't want? Man, they can rattle that shit off like nobody's business. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
So the idea is that we want to get better at the other and not so great at understanding what we don't want. We're all pretty fucking clear about what we don't want, I think. By this point, all of us are a little like, I got it. I get the message. Fucking done. I don't need to hear it anymore. So now it's time to get super like connected with the things that we do want, which is talking about why we're worthy of it. It's the things that we know to be true. Like, we know that we have, you know, the ability to have this in our life because we know we have good intentions as human beings. We know that we want to do good work. We know that we want to do it honestly. We know that we want to connect and impact people's lives. So when we connect more with that on a daily basis, then we're going to bring more of it into our life regularly. Yeah.
I'm worthy of being influenced. It's all the same thing.
Right. So you're seeing that, A, that connection over and over again. But you're also seeing it probably with a little bit of new perspective now, because you're thinking, okay, this is what I've known to be, but for some reason or another, I'm not aligning with that. And why? I need to ask myself that bigger question. Like, why am I not aligning with that regularly and allowing it to really show up in my life that way? Which is why you don't necessarily have the abundance factor that is like, there's money in your bank account and there's no worries and what have you, right? There's a little disconnect there. And it's just about really moving into more and more alignment of source. Really.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it just really comes down to that. Okay, so we're going to empty out again. So we can accept today that if the universe has the power of giving us this amazing desire and abundance and ideas of what we want that are really exciting. Like, I'm going to live on a boat. I'm going to live in a fucking boat. And I'm going to bring people to my boat.
Okay.
And I'm going to bring people to I'm going to meet people in islands to coach with them and have groups of people that are amazing, that are gonna be my soulmate tribe. Okay, when I know these things are gonna happen and I'm placing them into my little basket of desires, right? If the universe has the power of giving me these ideas, can we not expect then that the universe has the ability to place the things in front of us, right, to accomplish those things, right?
Right.
I mean, it seems natural to assume that they have the power to deliver it, right? So we're going to empty out again, because we always have to add to the pot. If you're not constantly adding to your abundance pot, basket, list, whatever you want to call it, then you are going to stay stagnant in your desires. You're going to wonder why it's not showing up, and it's just another way of holding you back. Okay, so we're going to empty out again. I want you to, this is a never-ending story, and this is where this has to be fun. Like abundance, this game has to be fun all the time.
Okay.
It has to be really feel good, and it needs to feel like, oh, like I can like dream and like, you know, put some cool shit into my basket, and I can think that it never can happen, but I can still put it in there. Absolutely. Like, I want you to really do that. Go outlandish. Okay. I want you to really, you know what you want. You think you're putting things into your basket that you think is attainable. That's what we're programmed to do in some degree. But I want you to go to the next level now. I want you to take things and put things into your basket that feel like, I have no idea where that came from. Where the fuck did, you know, opening an animal shelter come from? What? You know what I mean? Like that kind of, like, I want you to go outlandish, because I think it opens the floodgates to possibility. So I want you to really empty out again. So write out the most fun ways you can think of in creating abundance for yourself. It doesn't matter if it's something that you know how to do or you don't know how to do, something that you're skilled at or have absolutely no idea how to create. I just want you to pour out and empty out again. Okay, that's your next step. Okay, so we emptied out again, right, of like the outlandish things that we would like want to welcome into our life, the best ways we could create abundance in our life, doing the craziest whatnot ways. That's just a good practice and a good way of kind of connecting with things that don't really feel like they're connected to us somehow, but we can create abundance through them, because it brings new ideas to the things that we already know that we can do. It allows us to put more things into our basket, because this is a never-ending story. We seem to think that once we get to our abundant place, that we're going to feel whole, we're going to feel at peace, we're going to feel like things are good. But what we don't understand is that you're never going to feel that way. And that's the kind of cog in the wheel here. If we can get comfortable with knowing that we're always going to want more, even when we hit this space of like, oh my gosh, I am bringing those $2,000 in a month, you know, or that $5,000, $10,000, $50,000 a month. When you know that you're in that space and then you realize, oh shit, I want more. Oh, now that means that I'm always going to want more, because you're ambitious, you want to serve, you want to have impact. In order to have, you know, that evolution over a time that you don't even know what is yet, right? You don't even know, because you don't even know how big it can actually get yet. Until you understand that, you know, you're always going to want more, that it's going to be a never-ending thing, that you always have to put stuff in the desire basket, right? You're going to always have to put stuff in the abundance basket. I think what Abraham calls it, the vortex, right? You're always going to have to put things into the vortex. And the idea is like, okay, get out of the vortex and into my bank account, because that's what I need it to do so I can pay my bills, right? But if we're not constantly feeding that basket and adding things to it, we're gonna constantly have these little things in the basket that have always been there, and they're somehow never like coming to fruition, because we're thinking so small, and we're thinking, you know, very small accomplishments, and we're not growing. It's not, the basket's not growing, the new possibilities aren't coming in, and the new opportunities aren't going out, right? So I want that to be an exercise that you use regularly, okay? So where you're going to create, before we're done with this, we're going to create an abundance practice with everything that we've learned today. So this is a practice, because we've done a lot of practicing on, you know, all these behaviors and what have you that we've already recognized that we practice all the time, that we don't practice abundance. Blueberries. That's all I'm going to say. Blueberries. I love that that's now going to be for my group of people too, that blueberries are going to be a thing after us. Buy the fucking blueberries. So I want us to create a practice that allows us to really lean into the idea that abundance is always there, it's always available to us, that is regular, because you have spent decades probably at this point in your life practicing otherwise. So we got some work to catch up on. Luckily, this can happen really quickly. That's the cool part. Once you realize these things, it happens really quickly. So creating our abundance practice. This has to be practiced because it's just like anything. If you want to get good at anything, you practice it. Whether you want to be a good basket weaver or a good dancer, or you want to get really good at your job, there is a certain level of practicality and practice that you're going to have to implement into it. So first, I want you to mentally get into a state that lifts you. How do you get into a state that mentally lifts you? This is where your list from before comes into handy, right? Least resistance spaces. Okay, so this is your first part of your practice. That might be music that lifts you, right? Just lifts your mood, okay? It might be reading memes, watching cat videos. it could be so many different things, but I want you to get into a mental space that lifts you and makes you feel like I can get some good juice going, right? And you can do this in your morning meditation. I encourage you to do this in the morning before your serotonin levels start messing with your melatonin levels and whatnot, okay? So it's really good to do this in the morning before you start your day. It's just to chemically get you prone and primed to have an awesome day. So a couple things that mentally lift you, all right? And you can add to this list as you go, but I'm gonna go to the next one, which is what physically lifts you. Is that dancing around your apartment? Is that getting a run in or a workout in the morning? Is that doing a stretch class or yoga, right? Is that, just walking and being in nature, right? That's hugely like a big thing for me. I love to walk. I love to walk in the city now because it's like new energy for me versus where I came from, which is the suburbs, which was a little dead. So for me, I love to walk. All right, so it can be physically, I want you to get into a space that physically lifts you. Now, if you don't have the time in the morning to do a city walk, obviously, then you need to physically come up with something that's in your space, right? So it could be literally just a 5-minute thing that gets you into a physicality that lifts you going, I did something good for my body. 5 minutes is all it would take, right? So I want that to be a part of it. The next thing is what you have little resistance to, reevaluate that. You know, find just a good happy thought. It could be just one to get you kind of ready to move into the next piece. So you started with a little of that, just mentally lifting you, but it could be something outside of that, like I said, music or things like that. So if you haven't already brought in the little resistance piece, bring that in at this point. Butterflies, antiques.
Pretty flowers,
right. Okay, so anything that's kind of got some levity to it that you don't have resistance to. That's your step three. Number four, look at what's in your abundance basket right now. What you're asking for, what you're calling in, what you're really feeling that you need to connect with. Recognize what that is, okay? So it's just concentrating and putting some focus into that space and being able to go, you know, I know that I'm bringing this into my world. I know that I am bringing more opportunities that are going to result in the abundance into my world. I know that I am bringing more people and connections into my world that's going to result in a better abundance. So whatever that abundance is for you, it's going to be different for everybody bringing into your life. That's what's going to be next, okay? And your fifth final one is new things. We're going to add new things every day to your abundance basket. Now, don't think that, oh my God, okay, yesterday I asked for being on stage with Gwen Stefani. Okay, tomorrow it's got to be like, I've got to dance with Fred Astaire somewhere in time. Like, I don't want you to think of it as like these big epic things every day. They could be really small little simplistic things that are gonna add to your abundance basket, which means, you know, like Carmen is to build up her garden. I wanna add something to the garden. am I going to add to the garden and add something new to the abundance basket? I want to add like $50 to my bank account every week. What would that look like? I'm going to take a class. I'm going to learn something new. I'm going to bring in a new skill. So, you know, I'm going to invest in myself, you know, $100 so I can bring in $50 a week or a month to add that to my abundance basket. So you're going to constantly ask yourself each day, and it doesn't always have to be financial. So let's recognize that too, right? It could be spiritual. Oh, I don't know anything about Buddhism. So I'm going to bring in Buddhism into my life and learn a little something and see what I can take from that and implement into my life. I did this even with my child the other day. I told him, go look up Buddhism and tell me three things about it. And now he knows a little more about it, right? Mm-hmm. It's just adding to his abundance basket. It's not necessarily financial. It's just something that's going to make abundance flow more freely to you. And the more that you bring that into practice, the more financially you'll believe it can come into your mind as well and to your life as well. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Like taking a second yoga class, what would that look like?
Right.
A different type of yoga class.
Right, a different maybe, yeah, like, you know, maybe it's, you know, one day it's vinyasa and the other one it's like a hatha or whatever, right? So it's, you know, finding out the nuances of how they're different and being able to recognize that and kind of going, oh, this is a game, like, how is it going to be different, you know? It might be cool, hot yoga another day or whatever.
Right, change it up a little bit.
Yeah, it might be kind of fun. Or then it's like, well, like, how could I, like, I'll take a yoga fusion class. Oh, it's like fitness and fusion, like yoga. Oh, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
You know, so it's really just opening your mind to that kind of availability and that kind of abundance into your world. And that is your practice. This is something that shouldn't really take you that long to do every day. It can be kind of tagged on to the end of a meditation in the morning, really. You do a 10-minute meditation. You'd spend 5 minutes doing the rest of this, you know, or doing it before. Whatever you feels good to you, it really should just feel good to you, right? You do it before and it's kind of prepping and priming yourself for a really great meditation, or you do it to anchor your meditation. Whatever feels really good to you, okay? But this should be a part of your practice, because if you're not practicing this regularly, it's just like anything, just like a muscle. Like if you don't exercise it, it's not gonna get more refined.
Right.
It's the same thing, it's your brain, it's the same thing. So let's treat it the same way, with the same intensity, with the same excitement, with the same, you know, prosperity, and allow it to grow and build and thrive, feeding it with the right stuff.
Right.
Cool?
Yeah.